Esther chapter 8. Do a quick review. There are three parties in the capital of the empire, 180 days, 7 days, and the women's party. Vashti was invited to dance in front of the king and his nobles, and she said, no, thank you very much. She gets booted out, and a beauty pageant ensues, and Esther's invited to be part of that beauty pageant. So Mordecai uncovers an assassination plot, never gets rewarded for it. Haman is offended by Mordecai. He would not bow, even though the king commanded it. So Haman decides he's going to try to wipe out the Jews, the epitome of anti-Semitism, which has occurred ever since the days of Abraham. There's a party in the palace and mourning in the streets when the king says, go ahead, Haman, and do that edict. Here's my ring. Seal it up. And we reach the high point where Mordecai is asking Esther to go in and speak to the king. And he says to her, maybe you were born for such a time as this. And Esther's response, after she deliberates, she says, I'm going to go in there. And if I perish, I perish. So Esther comes before the king. The king extends his royal scepter. She says, my request, you'll give me up to half the kingdom. All I want is for you and Haman to come to dinner. Haman and the king go to dinner. The king asks her again, what would you like to have? And she says, how about dinner number two? Haman, of course, goes home. He's full of pride. His name means magnificent. And he's boasting to his wife and his friends. But he's all sad sack because Mordecai would not bow. Zeresh's wife has this great idea. Let's build a swing set out in the backyard, 50 cubits high, 75 cubits high, and you can hang Haman on that thing. And then after you hang him, you can go back to dinner for dinner number two. But that night, the king couldn't sleep. And what does he do? He gets his young men to come and read from his chronicles, and they say there was an assassination plot, and Mordecai told on them. And the king says, what did we do for Mordecai? And they said, nothing. Well, in the meantime, Haman has no clue that the king couldn't sleep. And he's going to the courts to ask to tell the king to kill Mordecai. Why? Because as far as Haman was concerned, all this is worth nothing to me as long as Mordecai will not bow. So the tables are turned. The honoree wannabe becomes the honorer, and Haman gets to lead the horse through the city and shout out, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delights to honor. Take that same quote and apply it to how Mordecai may be thinking. He's thinking, all this is worth nothing to me because my people are going to die. So there you have the two different quotes, the two different thoughts from two different people. And I bring up Jim Elliot, missionary to South America, who was martyred. He is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Continue with the storyline. Haman puts the royal horse back in the stable. He puts the royal clothes into the laundry. He goes home moping to his wife, and his wife pronounces his death sentence. She says, if Mordecai, since he's a Jew, you're going to die. At that point, the eunuchs come and rush him off into banquet number two. And meanwhile, the king, he didn't sleep the night before. He probably took a nap. He's ready to go to dinner with his wife. He's ready to go. And Haman and the king go to the banquet. But Haman, not so much. He didn't take a nap and he wasn't ready to party. Chapter 7, Esther begs for her life and the lives of her people, and she accuses Haman. And she says, Haman did it. And the king says, who is he and where is he who has dared to do this? And she says, a foe and an enemy, this wicked Haman. And of course, Haman was terrified before the king, and we brought up two thoughts. There was an acrostic hidden in the script. Who is he? I am. Moses said, who shall I say sent me? And the voice from the bush says, tell them I am sent you. And of course, this wicked Haman in the Hebrew alphabet adds up to 666. Now it's And now it's Haman's turn to beg for his life. Little typo there. He trips while approaching Esther. The king is thinking he wants to kill my wife. He wants to rape her beforehand. So to the gallows he goes. And we're going to see a series of scriptures from the Old Testament as we start pulling these things together, not just prophecy of what is happening to the Jewish people in this slice of history, but also prophecy of what is happening when Jesus comes back again. And as we go through some of these scriptures, keep in mind Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, the Hall of Faith, talks about all these great heroes of the faith and all the wonderful things that happened. But then the second half of Hebrews chapter 11 talks about the people who didn't have such a grandiose ending. People that were burned, people that were sawn in half, people that were martyred for their faith. But if you shall indeed obey his voice and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy to your enemies. I made the comment last time that the observant Jews are exposed to lots of scripture. I mentioned to you that I was invited to the synagogue, one and only opportunity, but it was 2 days back to back, this past Feast of Purim. And before they started the service, they had a prayer meeting. They were praying this prayer that they call the Kaddish, for whatever they were praying for the dead. We're not going to go down that line. But I'm reading along with this Kaddish, and as I'm reading, I can see verses from Psalms. No references, but just as we're reading, all these verses are all tied together inside this prayer. And so if you're an observant Jew, you get exposed to this stuff on an ongoing basis. And so the scriptures we're going to cover may or may not have been running around in the brains of Mordecai and the brains of Esther and the brains of the people. But let's just make a monster leap of faith and say, yes, they were. How they relate to the future, not so much. But how they related to the history, right on. But if you shall indeed obey his voice, and Mordecai did, and do all that I speak, Mordecai and Esther both did, then I will be an enemy to your enemies. So that brings us to chapter 8. On that day, King Ahasuerus gave to Queen Esther the house of Haman, the enemy of the Jews. He didn't waste any time. On what day? The day that Haman was put to the gallows. On that day, Zeresh becomes a widow, and in the course of the next 9 months, she becomes childless. And on that day, she became homeless. So over the course of that year, Zeresh, which means miserable, became a widow, she became childless, and she became homeless. And Mordecai came before the king, for Esther had told what he was to her. She didn't tell the king that she was a Jew. She didn't tell the king that he was her cousin. And all these pieces are now starting to come together. We spent the first time on introduction and overview. We're laying all of the base for this, and now things are coming together. And the king took off his signet ring, which he had taken from Haman, and gave it to Mordecai. And Esther set Mordecai over the house of Haman. And they lived happily ever after. That's how the fairy tales end. This was no fairy tale. And they lived happily ever after. Houston, we have a problem. And the story that we're reading right now isn't just a story. It isn't Tom Hanks in his younger days as an actor. It was Jim Lovell, who was out there and no reasonable way to find his way home. And his understatement was, Houston, we have a problem. What was the problem that Esther and Mordecai had? That law, that edict that went out to the 127 provinces could not be revoked. Now, I want to study on that word revoked. Different translations use different words. But what we're going to see is that when Esther is begging for the lives of her people, she's going to ask the king to revoke the law. back in the times of Persia, the king was not above the law. This particular quote comes from Daniel in the lion's den chapter. And the king did not want Daniel to go into the lion's den, but the king could not revoke the law. And the same is true here with King Xerxes. He could not revoke the law. Houston, we have a problem. So here comes Esther. Then Esther spoke again to the king. She fell at his feet and wept. I say unfair for guys, because if a guy went in front of a guy and he started crying and carrying on, might not have had the same impact on the king as his wife. This, back in those days, women were not even second-class citizens. This woman crying to him. So she fell at his feet and wept and pleaded with him to avert the evil plan of Haman the Agagite and the plot he had devised against the Jews. And when the king held out the gold scepter to Esther, Esther rose and stood before the king. The Bible tells us that we can go boldly to the throne. Now, boldly doesn't mean, hey, dad, give me this, give me that. It means confidently. We can go confidently to God because we have access to the throne because of faith and because of grace. And she said, if it pleased the king, then how many times has she started her conversations with her husband this way? It's humility. It's respect. Peter said that the wives are supposed to call their husbands master. Well, my wife has never called me master, but guess what? She respects me and she loves me. And these are different times. If it pleased the king, and if I have found favor in his sight, and if the thing seems right before the king, and I'm pleasing in his eyes, let an order be written to revoke the law. She is asking the king to flip the whole jurisprudence of the Persian Empire. Let an order be written to revoke the letters devised by Haman the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha, which he wrote to destroy the Jews who are in all the provinces of the king. For how can I bear to see the calamity that is coming to my people? Or how can I bear to see the destruction of my kindred? Keep in mind, she's the queen. The king understands the plan. If the plan were not subverted, the people are going out. Do you think maybe the king would protect Esther and those that were close to her? I think maybe so. And so she's saying, hey, I'm safe now, but what about the people that are around me? How can I bear to see the destruction of my people? It's a New Testament application. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time, he may exalt you. Esther came to the king with her face to the ground and weeping. And what did the king do? He extended the scepter and she got up and they had a face-to-face conversation. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. And again, borrowing from Daniel, you are greatly loved. The right thing to do. Esther chapter 8 and verse 5. Many times doing the right thing is easier than figuring what is the right thing to do. So what's the right thing to do? Then the king said to Queen Esther and to Mordecai the Jew, behold, I've given Esther the house of Haman, and they have hanged him on the gallows because he intended to lay hands on the Jews. But you may write as you please with regard to the Jews in the name of the king and seal it with the king's ring. For an edict written in the name of the king and sealed with the king's ring cannot be revoked. What he's saying is, Esther, Mordecai, you can't repeal that law, but you're welcome to do whatever you can to avert the destruction. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. There was a death sentence on me. And no matter what I would do, I couldn't get out from underneath that death sentence. Because according to the law, I must die. But Jesus said, I came not to destroy the law, but to fulfill the law. And as he was dying, he said, it is finished. And so by decree of the king, he averted that law, the Mosaic law, that I had to die. The wages of sin is death. And he gave me eternal life. And he seals me, just like we read up there, to be sealed with the king's ring. I'm not sealed with the king's ring. I'm sealed with the king's Holy Spirit. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. And how could I be sealed? Jesus bore the sin of me, past, present, and future, and of the whole world. The book of Hebrews says he died once for all. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The king's scribes were summoned at that time. In the third month, so they had 9 months to get the message out. The king's scribes were summoned at that time in the third month, which is the month of Sivan, on the 23rd day. And an edict was written according to all that Mordecai had commanded concerning the Jews to the satraps and the governors and the officials of the provinces from India to Ethiopia, 127 provinces, to each province in its own script and to each people in its own language, and also to the Jews in their script and their language. The Bible was written, Old Testament, the vast majority of it in ancient Hebrew. Some portions of it were written in Aramaic. The New Testament was written in Greek. And over time, those scriptures somehow survived. You study the Dead Sea Scrolls and locked up in some pot in some cave for hundreds of years, only to come out and show that all the copies from all those different manuscripts and all the parchments kept a huge degree of accuracy. And then we go through the Middle Ages where the scriptures become locked up. The Vulgate became Latin. The monasteries had it, the priesthood had it, but the people didn't have it. And a great awakening comes in a combination of the Reformation period along with the invention of the printing press. And now the scriptures are in the hands of anybody who wants to have them. And we're accountable for those scriptures. We're accountable for the opportunities that we've been given to learn. And he wrote in the name of the king and sealed it with the king's signet ring. Then he sent the letters by mounted couriers. They went by Pony Express, riding on swift horses that were used in the king's service, bred from the royal stud. Now, wouldn't it be interesting if that royal stud, that stallion, was the horse that Mordecai got to ride? And now it isn't Mordecai that's riding, but it's the message that's riding across all the youngsters that were born from that stud to the 127 provinces. They sent the message saying that the king allowed the Jews who were in every city to gather and defend their lives, to destroy, to kill, and to annihilate any armed force of any people or province that might attack them, children and women included, and to plunder their goods. Now, it's not spoken here, but this is another one of those things where God stepped in. We know that the Persian army was huge. At one point, they had 2.5 million soldiers. Why didn't Haman write that the soldiers would kill off the Jews. Because if that were the case, a bunch of Jews in guerrilla warfare could not withstand the Persian army. Instead, it was simply the common person is welcome to go and kill the Jews. And so the Jewish people in their guerrilla warfare would be able to protect themselves. This comes from Jeremiah. Those who plunder you shall be plundered, and all who prey on you, I will make a prey. On one day throughout all the provinces of the king, on the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month of Adar, a copy of what was written was to be issued as a decree in every province, being publicly displayed to all peoples. And the Jews were to be ready on that day to take vengeance on their enemies. Again, we pull together some verses that the observant Jew may have in the backs of their brains. No weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Well, the Old Testament Jew doesn't have that, but we do. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Keep in mind this wicked Haman, 666. The Jewish people were facing real live human beings, but the power behind all of that was satanic. The power of anti-Semitism has been around ever since Pharaoh trying to drown babies, to Haman here, to Herod. And even after Jesus has come and gone, you go through the Spanish Inquisition, you go through the World War II, you go through Stalin. Jews have been killed throughout the entire course of history. And they're not up against just people. Their enemy really is Satan. So the couriers, mounted on their swift horses that were used in the king's service, rode out hurriedly. They had 9 months, but they rode out hurriedly, urged by the king's command. And the decree was issued in Susa, the citadel. The decree was issued in the capital city. Now keep in mind what was going on inside that capital city. And people talk. When the wise men came to Herod and they wanted to know where baby Jesus was born, the Bible said the city was troubled. So here we have this city, and I mentioned a number of times, the Jewish people were solid citizens, and when the message came out that they were going to die, they were confounded. And now this issue comes out, and what we're going to see is the people are going to rejoice. And the decree was issued in Susa, the citadel. Then Mordecai went out from the presence of the king in royal robes of blue and white and with a great golden crown and a robe of fine linen and purple. And the city of Susa shouted and rejoiced. So here's Mordecai. He starts the story wearing just common street clothes. The edict comes out that his people are going to die. He trades in his street clothes, or probably more realistically, he did trade in his street clothes because he's wearing sackcloth. He's wearing burlap. You don't go running around in burlap by choice. Yeah. He trades in his street clothes for sackcloth and ashes. Then for one day, he swaps that out for the royal robes. He goes from the royal robes back to his sackcloth and ashes. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us that between the time of the sackcloth and ashes and the time of banquet number 2 and the time he gets presented to the king, if he ever cleaned himself up. But I'm going to imagine that he did. Just like Joseph, he was in the prison. And before Joseph got to go from the prison to the presence of Pharaoh, the Bible says he cleaned up and he shaved. So Mordecai is now back to street clothes. He's in this process. He just got done, and maybe he was not there as Esther's making the original requests, but now Esther introduces Mordecai, happens to be my cousin. Remember the assassination plot, hubby? She entered, yes? You that was just a wow. You're allowed to wow anytime you want, buddy. Street clothes, sackcloth and ashes, royal robes on a borrowed basis, sackcloth and ashes, street clothes, and now these royal robes for his very own. Psalm 30. You've turned from me my mourning into dancing. You have loosed my sackcloth and clothed me with gladness. The clothing was nothing more an outward expression of what was going inside his heart. He went from normalcy, street clothes, to repentance, sackcloth and ashes, to, I'll say, forgiveness. In his case, it wasn't forgiveness because he did nothing wrong, but an abatement of the evil, and then clothing of rejoicing. When the righteous increase, the people rejoice. But when the wicked rule, the people groan. Keep in mind, it was a 12-month edict, and there were 3 months that went on before this whole process of the two banquets and the forgiveness. So for 3 months, the people are confounded, the people groan. The Jews had light and gladness and joy and honor. And in every province and in every city, wherever the king's command and his edict reached, there was gladness and joy among the Jews, a feast and a holiday. And we're going to read as we go in for chapters 9 and chapters 10 that they're going to inaugurate the Feast of Purim. And that is truly a feast, a holiday of joy and gladness and honor and light. Isaiah, you shall have a song as in the night when a holy solemnity is kept, and gladness of heart as when one goeth with a pipe to go into the mountain of the Lord, to the mighty one of Israel. Now, in every synagogue around the world, people are celebrating Purim. But this verse is not talking about Purim. Look at that, into the mountain of the Lord. The mountain of the Lord is pointing to the millennial reign. When Jesus Christ comes back, Daniel 9, verse 24, he's going to set foot on the Mount of Olives. He's going to procession down through the Kidron Valley. He's going to come up onto the Mount of Zion. The Bible says there'll be an earthquake that splits north to south, and a river will flow from out from underneath the threshold of the temple. It'll flow to the Mediterranean. It'll flow to the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea water will be purified to the point where they're drinking the waters. And I take all this stuff very literally. And Mount Zion becomes the mount. All through Scripture, whenever they're talking about going up to Jerusalem. This time it will physically be they go up to Jerusalem. The Bible tells us that 10 people will get a hold of the garment of the Jew and say, take us to see the king. That's the rejoicing that they're talking about here. And the Purim is nothing but a precursor to that situation. And that's the moment when all of Israel will be saved. Chapter 9. Now, in the 12th month, we just talked about the third month, and the edict went out, and the time goes past. And so here we are when that day approaches of Haman's edict. Now, in the 12th month, which is the month of Adar, on the 13th day of the same, when the king's command and edict were about to be carried out, on the very day when the enemies of the Jews hoped to gain the mastery over them, the reverse occurred. The Jews gained mastery over those who hated them. The Jews gathered in their cities throughout all the provinces of the king to lay hands on those who sought their harm. And no one could stand against them, for the fear of them had fallen on all peoples. That particular area, first of all the way back in Genesis, when God told Abraham to go and sacrifice Isaac, he said, go to Moriah, which is a mountain range. Okay. Mount Zion is a particular spot on that mountain range, as is Calvary. Now, one could say they're all one in the same spot, but they're all localized right there in Jerusalem. Mark, would you like to add to that?
What's the mountain Moses went up on?
That was Mount Horeb or Mount Sinai, and that's the very bottom of Saudi Arabia.
Yes, it was not over in the Sinai Peninsula. And the Red Sea they crossed was crossing from Sinai over into Arabia. So
in the book of Galatians, there are two interesting mountains that you brought up. The book of Galatians says you've got Mount Sinai, which is the law, and you have Mount Calvary, which is grace. You have Sarah, who's a freeborn woman, and you've got Hagar, the slave. And he says, you can't have those two women. You got to throw one out. And you throw out the law, and you throw out the slave, because we are freeborn. The Bible says in Galatians, it says, stand firm in the liberty that Jesus gave us through the cross, Calvary. So when Jesus came, Palm Sunday, same route. He started on Mount Olives, Kidron Valley, rode that little donkey into the city, and all the people started shouting, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And the people rejoiced. But now at the end times, Jesus is going to come out of heaven on a white horse, Revelation chapter 19. The Bible says he'll be on a white horse and his vesture will be dipped in blood. And he's going to come down and he's going to fight against that Antichrist. And the beast and the false prophet will be thrown into the lake of fire. The serpent, dragon, will be put into the bottomless pit. And he's going to set foot down on Mount of Olives. He's going to trade in his white horse for a donkey. He's going to trade in his robes, his vestures dipped in blood, for clean robes. And he's going to ride that donkey right back up into that same city of Jerusalem. And the people are going to rejoice once again. And the Bible says, and they will look upon him whom they have pierced. When he went in there the first Palm Sunday, he wasn't pierced yet. That happened later in the week. But when he comes in the second time, the Bible says they will look upon him whom they have pierced. And they're going to look at Jesus and they're going to say, how could something like that happen to you? And the response will be, this was done in the house of my friends. This was done right there in that same city of Jerusalem. And the Bible says that God is going to put an end to the transgression of Jacob. The Jewish people from the very start had a problem with idolatry. From Aaron and the golden calf all the way through the entire course of history. And he's going to say, okay, we're done with that stuff. I'm the one and the true God. And the people are now going to worship him with no other thought about any other God. Really cool stuff, and I can't wait. Now, where are you going to be when all that happens? The Bible says that if you've been saved, the next thing on God's calendar is the rapture. You and I are going to be changed. The Bible says in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. The Bible says this mortal body will put on immortal, this corruptible body will put on incorruptible. And the Bible says we will meet him in the air and we will be with him forever. So wherever Jesus is in that discussion of the book of Revelation and Zechariah and Isaiah and 2 Thessalonians, that's where I'll be. And that's where you'll be if you're saved. The rapture takes me to heaven. I'm in heaven when all this Antichrist stuff is going on and Jesus Christ comes back. The Bible says we'll be coming with him mounted on horses. And the Bible says we will rule and reign with him for 1,000 years. So the Jewish people get the real estate from the Nile to the Euphrates, but the whole earth will be under the domain of Jesus and we will help him to rule and to reign for 1,000 years. Questions before we come back to the study? No, you're okay? Good. And no one could stand against them, for the fear of them had fallen on all peoples. All the officials of the provinces and the satraps and the governors and the royal agents also helped the Jews, for fear of Mordecai had fallen on them. You could think, well, that was political. Mordecai is now the prime minister. These people better be helping out the Jews. For Mordecai was great in the king's house, and his fame spread throughout all the provinces, for the man Mordecai grew more and more powerful. He got the ring, he was made the prime minister, but his power grew over time. The Jews struck all their enemies with the sword, killing and destroying them, and did as they pleased to those who hated them. In Susa, the citadel itself, the Jews killed and destroyed 500 men, and also killed. Haman had 10 sons, and I'm not going to try to read the names of those sons, but every one of those names has a meaning. And when you tie all those names together, there's a very interesting message. Again, the word God does not appear in this book at all. The word worship is not there. The word prayer is not there. But God is there. So they killed all of the sons of Haman, and we'll come back to those names shortly. The 10 sons of Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the enemy of the Jews, but they laid no hand on the plunder. So Mordecai finished the commandment that was given to Saul 500 years later. This is what the Lord told Saul. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I have noted what Amalek did to Israel in opposing them on the way when they came up out of Egypt. We studied where they opposed the Egyptians and the Israelites as they came out of Egypt. They opposed the Israelites in the time of Ehud, the left-handed judge. They opposed them in the times of Gideon, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. And they're opposing them at the time of Saul. And the Lord said, I've had it. Do away with Amalek. And Saul wouldn't obey. I have noted what Amalek did to Israel in opposing them on the way when they came up out of Egypt. Now, go and strike Amalek and devote to destruction all that they have. Do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, child, 10 sons of Haman, and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey. So you can understand how Samuel felt when Saul came back from battle and Samuel says, what meaneth the bleeding of the sheep? Because they were supposed to be dead. Not only did they spare the sheep, they spared Agag the king, the great-great-great-great-great-grandfather of Haman. Now here are those names of those 10 sons, and there are their meanings in that second column. But when you take those meanings, you can put that together in a large sentence, and this is how the sentence goes. When a person distances himself from God, when a person distances himself from the rigors, the habit of prayer and reading of the word, it leads to certain things. It leads to the wrong intentions. It leads to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes. It leads to the pride of life. The person's prayer life is ruined. His fellowship with the believers is distanced, and his words become poisonous. Doesn't speak good anymore. His strength is replaced with worry, and he becomes bitter and judgmental. That's where the evil leads. Haman was pure trouble, and Haman's sons, look at those names. Where does the departure from the Lord lead to? We just read the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. You give up on your prayer life. You give up on your Bible reading. You give up on your fellowship with the believers. You're all of a sudden not going to church anymore. And then you become boisterous, vulgar in your vocabulary. And all of a sudden the confidence that you had when you're living for the Lord is gone. And you become bitter and judgmental. That very day, the number of those killed in Susa the citadel was reported to the king. And the king said to Queen Esther, "In Susa the citadel, the Jews have killed and destroyed 500 men and also the 10 sons of Haman. What then have they done in the rest of the king's provinces? Now, what is your wish? It shall be granted you. And what further is your request? It shall be fulfilled." Notice here, Esther didn't ask for anything more. This was promoted by the king. Well, how did the king approach? I mean, how did Esther approach the king every other time? "If I found favor and if I'm pleasing to you and you, O king, please grant this thing." The king's now coming to her. And Esther said, "If it please the king, let the Jews who are in Susa be allowed tomorrow also to do according to this day's edict. And let the 10 sons of Haman be hanged on the gallows." Now, the 10 sons were already dead. The 10 sons were hanging on the were asked to be hanged on the gallows. The book of Deuteronomy says, "Cursed is everyone who hangs from a tree." Even Saul's body was hung up, and they came and took down the body and they buried it. And so she's asking for the humiliation and the ultimate cursing of those people. And there are some other people that still hated the Jews, and they needed an extra day to clean up the situation. So the king commanded this to be done. A decree was issued in Susa, and the 10 sons were hanged. The Jews who were in Susa gathered also on the 14th day of the month of Adar, and they killed 300 men in Susa, but they laid no hands on the plunder. Now the rest of the Jews who were in the king's provinces also gathered to defend themselves and got relief from their enemies and killed 75,000 of those who hated them, but they laid no hands on the plunder. Think of the math. 75,000 plus the several hundreds that were killed in Susa. But at that point in time, there could have been 1 million Jews. They had a long time the 70 years plus the 100, they had 170, almost 200 years to propagate. Not to mention what happened in Egypt that was also part of the province, not to mention what was happening up in Assyria from the northern tribes, not to mention what was happening down in Ethiopia for 500 years since Solomon's time. There are millions of Jews that were out there. This was on the 13th day of the month of Adar, and on the 14th day they rested and made that a day of feasting and gladness. But the Jews who were in Susa gathered on the 13th and the 14th day and rested on the 15th day because they needed that extra day to finish their cleanup exercise, making a day of feasting and gladness. Therefore, the Jews of the villages who live in the rural towns hold the 14th day of the month of Adar as a day of gladness and feasting, as a holiday, and as a day on which they send gifts of food to one another. So this is how the Purim works these days. It's a two-day festival. The first day is the reading of the scriptures, and basically people go back to their own homes and they exchange gifts. But then the second day, they're back again at the synagogue, but then there's a feast at the synagogue where people are not rejoicing just as family units, but as a Jewish community. And Mordecai recorded these things and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of the king, both near and far, obliging them to keep the 14th day of the month Adar and also the 15th day of the same year by year, as the days on which the Jews got relief from their enemies, and as the month that had been turned for them from sorrow into gladness and from mourning into a holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days for sending gifts of food to one another and gifts to the poor. From Jeremiah. Alas, that day is so great, there is none like it. The book of Zechariah says the same thing. There is no day like it. The sky was dim. There was never a day like that when Jesus comes back. And so this is also pointing to that particular day, but there are some symptoms here. Alas, the day is so great, there is none like it. It is a time of distress for Jacob, yet he shall be saved out of it. So how about some modern day Purim events? And the question is, were these coincidences? Purim in 1953, Joe Stalin dies during Purim. right before he executes his plan to ship most of the Jews of Russia off to Siberia. 1991, ceasefire is declared on the day of Purim, when Saddam Hussein wanted to do the same thing with the Jewish people. Purim, I mentioned earlier, it's a picture of the second coming. Behold, I will bring to it health and healing, and I will heal them and reveal to them the abundance of prosperity and security. I will restore the fortunes of Judah and the fortunes of Israel and rebuild them as they were at first. I will cleanse them from all the guilt of their sin against me, and I will forgive all the guilt of their sin and rebellion against me. And I already mentioned what was happening in Zechariah chapter 9, the return of Jesus on that day, and Daniel 9:23 and 9:24, you're greatly loved. Which brings us really to the epitaph of the book of Esther, chapter 10. The king imposed tax on the land and on all the coastlands of the sea. Now, I do not understand why that verse is in here, okay? The people are partying, everybody's happy, and all of a sudden, we've got some taxes. One of these days, I might figure it out. But the king imposed tax on the land and on the coastland of the sea, and all the acts of his power and might, and the full account of the high honor of Mordecai to which the king advanced him, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Media and Persia? Again, the cuneiforms, there are thousands of them yet to be translated. And how cool would it be if all those things get translated and we find the complete account of Mordecai? For Mordecai, the Jew was second in rank to the king, and he was great among the Jews and popular with the multitude of his brothers. Why? For he sought the welfare of his people and spoke peace to all his people. Shalom. He spoke shalom to all his people. Now borrow this from Genesis. And this is Joseph talking to his brothers. And his brothers really wanted to get rid of Joseph. They hated Joseph, just like Haman hates the Jews. And he says to the brothers, as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Right? God has not been mentioned at all inside this book, and yet we see that throughout the book, God arranged for Vashti to be booted out, arranged for the beauty pageant, arranged for Esther to be invited, forced into the competition, arranged for Esther to get special favor among the people, arranged for Mordecai to be able to communicate with Esther, even though they were locked up in the harem, arranged that the lot was cast to give an 11-month warning, arranged that the decree commanding that the Jews be killed by private hands instead of by the army, arranged that Haman would restrain his anger and not kill Mordecai immediately. Keep in mind, he was second in command. He was the prime minister. He was given the ring. He could have very easily said, guys, just kill him right then and there in his sackcloth and ashes. But no, he didn't do that. He was going to go and tell the king to do it. He arranged for Esther to delay her request so that the king could have a sleepless night. He arranged for Haman's anger to come to a peak on that particular day as he was leading Mordecai around on the royal stallion. He arranged for the king to have a sleepless night, and he arranged for the king to pick up a certain book and a certain page on the book. I don't think they read the whole book or the whole scroll. He arranged for the king to read the passage about Mordecai in that book. So what walls fell in Esther's day? Walls that fell in Esther's day, Joshua chapter 6, talking about Jericho. So the people shouted, and the trumpets were blown. As soon as the people heard the sound of the trumpet, the people shouted a great shout, and the wall fell flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they captured the city. What walls fell in Esther's day? There's no scene so dark that God cannot brighten it. There's no law so permanent that God cannot change it. keep in mind that Hebrews 6 says there are two immutable things that God cannot lie. Well, God cannot lie is the first one, and the second one is he's immutable. He cannot change. So he didn't get rid of the law. He fulfilled the law. No heart so hard that God cannot soften it. Modern example, the Berlin Wall fell. How did that happen? It happened with the prayers of God's people. The people behind that iron curtain, you know, they sacrificed their lives to get out from that wall, and finally that wall fell.
I got two pieces of it.
Nice. No sinner so wretched that God cannot save. God is able to save to the uttermost. Even Haman. Now, when we think of the last scene of Haman, he goes to Esther and begs for his life. We don't know what was in the heart of Haman, but let's just take it at face value. Instead of begging Haman for his life, he could have begged God for eternal life, and God could have given it to him. There are a number of scoundrels in our history, and we mentioned some of them today. We mentioned Adolf Hitler, mentioned Joe Stalin, mentioned Saddam Hussein. We didn't mention him, but Osama bin Laden. We don't know what went through their hearts as their life was coming to an end. Could they have been saved? The thief on the cross was saved.
One was.
He has done nothing amiss, that thief said. Lord, remember me when you enter into your kingdom. This day thou shalt be with me in paradise. When God wins, he often uses unexpected people. He used a donkey one time.
Balaam.
He used Joseph, who was a slave and a prisoner. He used Mordecai, a humble and foreign servant. Remember, Mordecai the Jew. And you could almost say that with a degradating voice. Mordecai the Jew. He used Moses, an 80-year-old, a convicted criminal. He used Rahab, the town harlot. He used Jonah, a renegade. He used Saul, converted him to Paul. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He said, of all sinners, I'm chiefest. He's the worst of the sinners. The qualities he upholds are usually unpretentious. You think of all those people that we mentioned, and none of those guys had pride on their chests. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. There was Esther. She wanted to save her own neck, but she wanted to save the necks of the people as well. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. So when God wins, he uses unexpected people, unpretentious people, and the message he honors most is universal. Seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare, you will find your welfare. When the world selects its major players, the criteria are much different. Dr. Dobson often talks about the values of individuals. Bob Lentz took that message onto the road. But Dobson would say that in today's society, people measure value in terms of their brains, their brawn, and their bucks. And the best example I could give would be in high school, okay? We'll start with the brawn. You got the captain of the football team. You take brawn and just translate it into beauty. You've got the captain of the cheerleaders. You got the person who shows up with his brand new driver's license, and he comes with the BMW that they gave him, okay? Now, in today's society, we've honored the brawn more than the brains, the valedictorian. In fact, now they're starting to say, well, we shouldn't have a valedictorian because it makes the runners up not feel so good. But the world looks at people differently. Saul versus David. Saul was a head above any of his peers. And they said, ah, he looks pretty kingly. Let's pick him. But David was ruddy in countenance. He was the youngest of the sons. He was the one that had to take care of the sheep. But the Lord said unto Samuel, well, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature. Keep in mind, Saul was king at the time and he had the big old stature. Or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Goliath versus David. If they had a betting program, all the odds would be on Goliath.
Oh, they were.
Goliath said, if your champion defeats me, we will serve you. And if we defeat your champion, you will serve us. Well, the Philistines reneged on that promise because Goliath went down and the Philistines continued to bother the Israelites. Caesar, Herod, the high priests versus Jesus. If you said, who were the rulers of the day? You would say it was Rome. If you're talking about religion, you would say it was the high priest. But Jesus said to Caesar, to Pilate, he said, you have no power except that it came to you from above. When the world looks for qualities to get the job done, the externals get the nod. But this is what James had to say. He gives more grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. When the world arranges its priorities, first and foremost, it looks out for number one. So who's the hero in the book of Esther? Was it Xerxes? Certainly not. Was it Vashti, the first feminist recorded? To an extent. Was it Haman? Certainly not. He was the villain. Was it Esther? You know, we hold Esther up and we see Christ and Esther as our advocate. Was it Mordecai? Sweet, fragrant, faithful, humble. The hero isn't even mentioned in the book. And the hero is God.